Okay, so the purpose of this meeting is to go over the Ensign architecture in its sort of current form. And I think the goal is to make it easier for everyone to write documentation and maybe to more fully understand what's going on in the back end. We certainly have a lot of topics to cover with this, and we probably won't get to everything. But I should say that if you have any questions, please either interrupt or raise a hand. And I want to make sure that I can answer some of those questions before we move forward. Okay, so this little drawing is sort of a quick overview of sort of the broad architecture with the major components and kind of the thing that I'm generally thinking about when I'm working on the back end, right? So I might be working on this sort of middle component here, which is Ensign and the work it does, but you know, these are sort of all of the moving pieces. So first, you know, Ensign, this Ensign node right here in the middle, this is the data storage node. It does a huge amount of work in order to manage events and to broker them between publishers who are creating events and sending them to Ensign, and making sure those events get out to consumers who are trying to read those events. So Ensign is kind of the thing that's in the middle. Ensign is also a distributed system. So there are multiple Ensigns that are running and have to coordinate with each other in order to make sure this brokering is happening correctly. And so, you know, you might see one publisher going to one Ensign and, you know, different consumers going to different Ensigns, different topics, you know, will be on different Ensign nodes. And so, you know, everyone has to get sort of to the right place and get the right data in order for this to all work out and for the thing to scale up. So there is a lot of coordination, you know, sort of between these Ensign nodes. Inside of Ensign, there are two main data stores. There's the events data store that holds all of the events that are being written by the publishers. And then there's the metadata store, which holds information about topics, consumer groups, placement. It just has a lot of other information that needs to be stored, but it shouldn't be stored with events, right? The event store is supposed to be a high throughput store, and the meta store is supposed to be a less high throughput store. Finally, there's quarterdeck, which is sort of the key to authentication inside of this system. Now you'll note that tenant and beacon aren't here. And that's because from Ensign's perspective, tenant is just sort of another consumer or possibly a publisher in some cases, right? But, you know, it's just a client that's reading from Ensign. So, you know, Ensign doesn't know anything specific about tenant, right? And tenant fronts beacon, right? So basically what tenant is a specialized program that interacts with Ensign and quarterdeck in order to provide a UI to the user. But that is ancillary to the Ensign architecture, right? There's no, you know, this thing doesn't need a UI, if that makes sense. So that's why it's not in this diagram, right? Tenant and beacon are like a specialized tool, but it doesn't have any sort of special access between these quarterdeck and Ensign. It does work on behalf of the users who are logged in. Now, someday we probably would want to put an administrative interface or something on here, you know, maybe, you know, like an admin UI on top of quarterdeck. And we'll certainly want sort of an admin system on top of Ensign, but that hasn't been thought about or implemented. So that's why those components aren't here either. So in terms of interactions, the main thing that we have in terms of most interactions is publishers will go to quarterdecks, and so will consumers for authentication. Let's see if I can draw this a little better. Right, and they use, you know, sort of the client ID and client secret. Terrible writing here. And they do that in order to get back an access token, right? And this access token has the org ID, the project ID, and the permissions. As well as the key ID, which is slightly less important. So once these sort of outer things have gone to Quarterdeck, you know, Quarterdeck downloads some JWT keys, and it uses the JWT keys to authenticate these access tokens. So Ensign and Quarterdeck actually don't talk very much, right? So every time a request comes in, Ensign doesn't say like, hey, Quarterdeck, is this valid or not? It just knows that you have an access token, and it knows whether that access token is valid or not. And if it is valid, then you know, it goes ahead and it uses those claims, the org ID, the project ID, and the permissions in order to create permissions. Now, there are a lot of ways that clients can interact with Ensign. So there's actually a whole host of topics RPCs. And the topics RPCs are things like list topics, create topic, retrieve topic, delete topic, archive topic. So, you know, those are sort of like unary RPCs where clients, both publishers and consumers, really any type of client, can sort of manage topics inside of their project with Ensign, right? And that's what Tenant does, right? Tenant does all these sort of topic queries to Ensign in order to manage the Ensign project on behalf of their client, right? So you might also think of this as like a manage project. And of course, these things respond to permissions, right? So if you have the create topic permission, you can create a topic, but if you don't, then you can't create a topic, right? If you have the edit topic permission, you can archive a topic, but you can't delete a topic or create a topic. Yes, thank you, Edwin. That's a good question. RPC stands for remote procedure call, right? So yeah, it's an API request coming from the client to an Ensign node. So thank you for asking that question. Remote procedure call. This can also be used to get info about the topic and the project, right? So, you know, how many events, how much data storage, you know, those things Ensign provides as well. And then the other thing that Ensign does, each Ensign node publishes meta events that can be subscribed to. And meta events are actually separate from the sort of events data structure right now. So I'm looking at, like right now we're publishing them to a topic that has an ID and that you have to have keys for, but we might do this a little bit differently in the future. It might be that you can we might create a permission called like meta events, and you can read meta events for your project. That might be how we do it instead, so that, you know, anyone can read the events on their project. It's just, and then Tenant will just have to get a one-time access rather than having a separate subscriber. So that's how I'm thinking about doing that. But yeah, the meta events are stored on each Ensign node sort of individually. Like they're not just events about a topic in a project, although you can think about it that way. They're also just like events about this node. Like, what is this node doing? What operations is it taking on? So this is kind of, there's a lot of stuff happening here. We need to talk about that in more detail, but obviously the primary reason that you want meta events, topic RPCs, managed project info, that kind of stuff, is because of this primary interaction where publishers will open, you know, a pub stream to send events to Ensign. And then consumers, I'll do this node here, open up subscribe streams to get events from the node, right? So this is the sort of primary reason for Ensign to exist, is to create these data flows where publishers are emitting data, right? They're emitting these events in real time, and Ensign in real time is making sure that the consumers get these events, right? That's the whole point of this system. So does anyone have any question about this slide? Ready? So I was thinking, like, probably the next important thing to talk about is, like, what is an event, right? And so an event is a datagram, right? Which means it's sort of an arbitrary blob of data that has been defined by the user, right? So this thing right here is just sort of just data. It's just binary data. And Ensign doesn't, like, really know what's in there, with some asterisks I'm gonna talk about in a second. In addition, users can put in metadata, which is key value pairs where the keys are strings and the values are strings, right? So this is key and then value. Now, we haven't really explored, you know, why this might be useful. A lot of other systems like NATS have metadata, and the metadata is sort of the sort of source of querying. So we want to make sure that these sort of arbitrary metadata key value stores are also going to enable querying right off the bat, right? So this is probably going to be the sort of primary query source. But we will talk about the secondary query source and being able to query into the data as well. So whereas data is just an arbitrary blob of data, metadata is strings, it's these key value pairs. There is a length limit to, like, how much data can be put into this metadata. Actually, I should annotate that here. Another good question, Edwin. So how does the user define the metadata? The answer is yes. When the user creates an event, they can put in the metadata into the event. And the way to do that currently is via the SDKs. That's currently the only way to publish events, is by using one of the SDKs. And it can be anything. So both data and metadata are completely user defined. Right? It's what the user puts into those fields, is what it is. We certainly need it to be in the docs, and get it there hopefully soon, which is part of the reason that we're discussing this today, is to make sure that we can figure out exactly what our users need to know and make sure that it's getting into the docs. So data and metadata don't tell us a whole lot about what's in there, but there are two pieces of information that we have that will allow the user to do more things. And these things are completely optional. So the first is the type, And the type has the form, you know, name at v1.0.0, right? So it has this sort of type name, and then it has this sort of semver versioning system. Now, originally, this wasn't a semver versioning system. It was just an incrementing versioning system. So it'd be like one through, you know, a billion. You could have, every time you change the version, it would just increment. We moved it to the semver versioning system. You know, we're still in beta. So if we think that semver is not a good versioning system, we can always sort of roll it back from the semver versioning system, because it does complicate things. But semver is, you know, easy to parse and easy to compare and things like that. So, you know, if the user doesn't want to use semver, they can always just increment the major version number and not worry about, you know, any of the other version component numbers. But that's what the type is. Now, the type isn't really all that great by itself. So this will eventually have to be connected to a schema registry. And we don't have a schema registry yet. But when we do have a schema registry, what the type will allow the user to do is to validate data before they put it into Ensign, right? So they can say, you know, this is a JSON document and these fields are required and this field must be a number and this field cannot be null and this field must be, well, maybe not unique, but you know, we, you know, uniqueness is another constraint that you can put in. So they can define a schema, right, for their data. That way, when publishers are putting in data, it guarantees that they're only putting in the correct data, right? And those guarantees might make it easier for the downstream subscribers to parse and handle and manage the data. And this is completely optional, right? There's no need to put in a type. By default, the type is unknown version zero. And if the type is unknown version zero, then you essentially have a NoSQL data store. They're just putting any blob data that they want. So it's not required, but if they do create a type, they do create a schema registry, then Ensign will be able to validate the data before it gets published, and it will make querying on the data possible. So right now, unless you have a type, you can't query in the data, right? Because Ensign can't read the data unless it knows what the type of the data is. So that's sort of one piece of it. The second piece of information is the MIME type, right? So the MIME type the MIME type basically says what is the data encoded as, right? So the MIME type is things like, you know, JSON, you know, message pack, Avro, protobuf, Parquet. You know, it's however the data is encoded inside of this, you know, data blob here, right? And that tells you how to parse it, right? How to parse the data into a structure that can be represented by the type. Now, some types we might be able to query on without a, or some MIME types we might be able to query on without a schema. So there are ways for, like, say, JSON and message pack that you can, like, query into JSON and message pack with the MIME type. But, you know, we just have to decide if that's something we wanted to do or if we just wanted to focus on the schema registry. But right now, most querying is going to focus on this sort of metadata up top here, just for now, just to make things simple. Now, the last thing that's at the top level is this created timestamp. And then this is just the time that the event, like the real world time, the clock time that the event was created. I'm not like sure why that's at the top level, but it is. So I think it's because users can specify their own local created timestamp if they want, right? So that's why it's at the top level. Then there is some other metadata, right? So this other metadata down here the event ID, the offset, and the topic are sort of separate from this event ID, from the event itself. So, you know, these are things that appear that the user can edit, right? So users can add all this stuff to an event, whereas the event ID, the offset, and the topic are things that they can't add to the event, right? So the topic that the event belongs to gets associated with the event when it's published. You have to publish to a specific topic. So that's when the topic gets added here. The event ID is an RL ID, which contains a timestamp plus a sequence number. So, and is totally ordered. And what that means is that means that you can totally order all events in Ensign using their RLID, right? And there may be conflicts, right? So it is possible for two events to have the same RLID, but they will never be in the same topic, right? So it's impossible for two events to have the same RLID in the same topic. It is possible for two events globally to have the same RLID, but that would be very unusual. But because it contains a timestamp, right, it is really, really unlikely that there's a clash between these things. And so for the most part, we can totally order all events in Ensign. And, you know, if we do see two events with the same RLID, we just order them by topic, right? So what that means is we can totally order all events in Ensign in an externalizable deterministic way. So that's a strong consistency part of Ensign. Now, if an Ensign node handles multiple topics, you can actually totally order all of the events between those topics because the sequence number is sort of global to the node. That's just a little bit of an interesting bit of trivia here. But the RLID, so the RLID is useful for establishing an order of events. Like this is how all of the events came in. This offset is a little different. The offset talks about like what event is this into the beginning of the topic, right? So, you know, the first event that is published to the topic, that's offset one, second event's offset two, and so forth. So the offset, you know, won't equal, the sequence number and the RLID, but both of them are monotonically increasing with respect to each other. So if you have offset 42 and RLID sequence number 100, then you can guarantee that the next offset in the topic is going to have a higher RLID sequence number than 100, if that makes sense. So that's how these things work. And both of these things can be used to query events from inside of Ensign, the offset and the RLID. The RLID can be used to fetch a single event, like I want this event with this RLID, and Ensign can be like, here you go. And the offset and the timestamp can be used to sort of query, you know, in time, right? Like I want everything from, you know, March 1st to March 31st, right? You know, the RLID has that timestamp, so it would be used to make that query. Or I want everything from offset 50 to 200, right? The offset would be used to make that query so that, you know, you can use this to query sort of back in time. Or I want to, you know, start at offset number 33. You know, those are all things that you can ask Ensign and you'll get the response. Any questions about events?
Can you explain like the where how the sequence number gets incremented again? Like when does that happen?
That's a good question. So every broker, and we'll talk about that on this slide. I'm teaching the wrong thing. So here's the broker. So let me just quickly draw out the broker diagram so you can see it. So the broker, there's only one broker per Ensign node. And this broker is like basically the core of Ensign. So, you know, basically you have this fan in. From pubs that go into the broker into a single pipe. And then the sequence is updated here in the broker. And then there's consensus. And then disk write. And then fan out to all these subs. So this is where the sequence is being updated. So basically every event that comes in from every publisher go routine, it goes into one pipe. There's only one broker. They're handled one at a time. The sequence number is updated for every single one that's coming in. If it's a raft quorum, then that sequence number is committed and all the events are committed across all of the raft nodes in Ensign. It's then written to disk and that point is published out to the subscribers. So yeah, it's the broker that sort of deals with that sequence number.
Okay, and the RL ID comes from the sequence number and the timestamp.
That's correct.
Okay, because that allows you to order things by time.
Yes. Yeah, so the RLID timestamp has a granularity down to some number that's in the documentation, but just for the sake of argument, like let's say it's 100 milliseconds, which is a long time, right? So that sequence number is what totally orders everything in that like sort of 100 millisecond time period. And it's like, you know, it's a UN32, so it turns out that there is a cap. Every Ensign node can only handle 4 million or 4 billion events per 100 milliseconds. But the laws of physics, I think, prevent that from ever actually happening.
Wait, was that 400 million or 400 billion?
Pretty sure it's 400 billion.
Okay.
Or not 400 billion per second. 4 billion per 100 milliseconds.
Got
it. No, 40 billion per second. Yeah.
I said okay. No, that's helpful.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, but we will never even come close. Like that's just like how high we can count to before bad things start to happen. But you know, Kafka does at best, you know, in the millions of events per second. So we will never even come close to those numbers. So I'm not worried about it at all.
Got it.
But this is also why, like if this broker is handling multiple topics, this is why all of these events are totally ordered within the topic. The only way that a conflict can happen is in the off chance, can I copy this? Apparently not. The only way a conflict can happen is if there's another Ensign broker, right, using a completely different topic, and the event comes in at the exact same time and they're at the exact same sequence, that's the only way a conflict can happen, right? And it's certainly possible, and the more events that you have going through the system, the higher the likelihood is that it will happen. But because we guarantee that each broker like is responsible for its own topic, right? it means that we can totally order by topic, right? So whatever the topic ID, that determines which one came first and which one came second. So we have completely strong consistency, total ordering of all events in the system to the granularity of 100 milliseconds, right? Like, is it possible that within 100 milliseconds, two events actually like in real time came one before the other? Yes, it's technically possible, but it doesn't matter because they will always be read in the same order. Okay, so let's talk about topics real quick. So topics are composed of a name, and the topic name is unique per project, right? So you can't have, you can have the same topic name in two different projects, but within the same project, you can only have one, you can only have a topic name with that name. It's unique. So the unique per project thing created sort of a complication, right? Which is we can't really index by topic name because there could be multiple topic names. So what we have to do instead is we have to index by you know, project ID, topic name, or by topic ID. So we kind of went with topic ID, which is a UL ID. So topic IDs are unique in Ensign, right? They're unique across the board because they're UL IDs. But, you know, most people don't care about the topic ID, they care about the name. So what we do is we do a murmur3 hash of the topic name plus the project ID. And this indexes to the topic ID. So it kind of sucks because it means that it's not that straightforward. Like if you give me a topic name, I can figure out what the topic ID is from that topic name. You know, you have to do this lookup in the database. You have to have both the project ID and the topic name in order to get the topic ID. And that is a little bit of a complication, but it saves us a lot of other types of trouble. So that's why we're doing it this way. Now, in addition to the name and the topic ID, you know, the topic is sort of, you know, the data store from the point of view from the user, right? All of their events go into a topic. So that means, you know, offset, number of events, you know, number of bytes, that kind of stuff is all from the project or from the topic. And then a project is just composed of topics. Right. So, you know, a topic is a project is sort of like a higher level consideration on like a collection of topics. And so you might ask these same exact questions that you would ask of a topic of the project. But the, you know, individual events are okay, but topics are like the collections, the groups of events. And so they're also very important on their own. But I think also kind of important, the questions that we have on the topic are, you know, placement, which answers the question, where is the data? Not where is that data, where is the data? So topics have to be placed on nodes in data centers. And data centers are in the real world, obviously. And when a topic is placed onto an Ensign node, right, the client has to go to that node in order to interact with the topic. So we have this problem, not of just what Ensign node manages what topics, but also how do we get the client to connect to the right Ensign node in order to create the correct stream there as well. So that's kind of a challenge. And right now everything's just on a single Ensign node, but that won't scale, right? Like, we need to be able to have multiple Ensign nodes handling multiple topics. And that's what the placement question is. Also, we will likely have customers who say, oh, I want my Ensign to be in Frankfurt and in Sao Paulo. And in that case, we have to have Ensign nodes in Frankfurt and Sao Paulo, right? And so that's like placement in terms of geography. So placement is like a really critical question for Ensign. Other critical questions for topics are encryption, right? So the data security of the events that are stored inside the topic and what keys are used to encrypt it, compression, right? How are we compressing and trying to reduce the data volume size? There's always a trade-off between the speed of compression and decompression and the amount of compression and decompression, right? So if you have faster compression, it doesn't usually get as small. If you have longer compression, it will get smaller, but it takes longer. So you have this balance between, you know, speed and size, and that's something the user might want to consider, right, as they're using Ensign. So placement, encryption, compression, and you know, I guess like archives, you know, if this is read only. And I feel like I'm forgetting something. There's also deduplication, which we'll talk about later. But these are all sort of considerations that go with the topic, right? How is Ensign actually dealing with the data that's inside of this topic on behalf of the user, right? Now, the one sort of main determining thing is that events inside of topics can only be read together inside of the same project, right? So like, it should never be possible that if a user reads from topic A, they get an event from topic B, right? That should never happen. That can't happen. And if you have topic A and topic B that are in the same project, it is possible to join the events from topic A and topic B, and to get like a single event that's composed of both types of events from A and B, or to get both the events from topic A and topic B, so long as they are in the same project. But if topic C is in a different project, it is impossible to get the events from topics A, B, and C, unless you have keys, API keys for both projects, right? So, you know, this is kind of the read model that's happening, and you may very likely be reading from different Ensign nodes to get all three of those topics if you do have API keys from all of the projects. It's impossible to join a topic A and topic C if they're two different projects, even if you do have two different keys. Ensign just can't do that. You can't join across projects. So that's topics. Any questions about topics that I missed? Okay, so let's talk about publishing and subscribing and the sort of the current state of things. Now, this is more of a discussion for like what it takes to build an SDK, but it might also be a discussion of like, how do we want to continue to build Ensign in the future? So right now, right, we have the Ensign gRPC server, right? That's terrible. Let me do some better writing here. And then we have, let's say there's a client over here. And when the client opens a publish request, this is bidirectional streaming. Now, the next part is true for both publish and subscribe. I don't know if I have time to go specific, and they're very, publish and subscribe are very similar, what I'm going to talk about right now. But when you open the publish bidirectional streaming, what happens on the server side is you get this publish handler, right? And there's similarly a subscribes handler, and both publish handler and subscribe handler are stream handlers, right? So they're meant to handle a stream, a single stream of events that's coming from a single publisher. Now, nothing happens at first because we expect the client to send a open stream message. And this will include topics and pub ID. And then also it'll have the access token. And then the client needs to do a recv. So what the publisher does is first, once it gets this OpenStream message, it first checks credentials and it'll send an unauthorized error back, which will only be viewable in recv, right? So nothing will error until you do your recv. So in the SDK code, you have to send this OpenStream and then you have to wait for this recv to find out if A, the credentials worked. It checks credentials. It also checks placement. So are you at the right Ensign node? And if you aren't at the right Ensign node, it will send back a redirect message. Hey, connect to this other Ensign node over here. So the SDK will have to be like, oh, oops, my bad. And it has to go connect to the other node on behalf of the user if the placement's not correct. It then checks the topics. Now, for the publisher, if you send topics with the publisher, it basically constrains what topics the server will allow you to publish to. If you send no topics, then you can publish any allowed topic. That, you know, it's not a big deal. But it checks the topics. If there are no topics for the project, it sends back an error. It says, hey, there's no topics. Although actually right now what it does is it panics and says name group is corrupted. But we'll fix that bug. but it does check the topics. And so for a subscriber, it makes sure that the topics that you're trying to subscribe to, you're actually allowed to subscribe to. And then after it checks the topics, it creates like a unique publisher ID. And this is based on the publisher ID that the client sends, plus the IP address that the client's coming in from, plus like a string that is created by the gRPC server, so it knows like what publisher is creating these events. And that's part of the provenance system, right? We know what publisher, we can compare like, oh, this publisher created this event, this publisher created this event. And then what it does is it goes to the broker and creates a broker publisher handler, like a pub broker, right? And so basically this is how the publisher handler communicates, sends events to the broker, and the broker will send acts and NACs back to the publisher handler. So it creates this little interaction between itself and the broker. And, you know, obviously if you have multiple clients, there'll be multiple publisher handlers, but there will only ever be one broker. And then it sends the, like once it's done all this, it sends the, you know, stream info. Actually, I can't remember what this is called, but, you know, it sends like, yep, I'm good, I'm ready, right? Go ahead and start publishing your events. And then what will happen is the publisher can just sort of send events. And the server will send acts and NACs back. Right. So this might be like the E1 NAC, the E2 NAC. This might be the E4 NAC, the E5 NAC. And then it might say, you know, E3 did not work. Right. And so it's up to the publisher whether or not it wants to check these acts and NACs. But for example, the publisher might want to say, like, if E3 got NAC'd, right, for some reason, event 3 couldn't be published. The publisher might want to retry it. If the order of events is really important, the publisher might wait until event 1 is published before publishing event 2, right? So you can see here, you know, what's happening is, you know, the publisher is not waiting, right? E1 gets sent, E2 gets sent. Only then does it hear that E1 got published. It sends E3, then it hears E2 got published. It sends E4. Now it's like, oh, E3 didn't get published. If it publishes E3, if it retries E3, it will come after E5, right? So if the publisher really wants to create strict ordering, it would wait until the act came back for each event before sending another one. But that obviously really slows down how fast this thing gets published. So, you know, it's a choice, you know, if it doesn't really matter, if you're just sending data, right? Like for an ETL job for Eisenhower, you know, just retry the row. It doesn't matter like what order they're in, right? It'll all be processed downstream. But if the order does matter, then you want to make sure that you're waiting for an ACK from the Ensign server before you can carry on. You can then close this stream, and then everything gets closed and cleaned up, and the publisher handler is no longer publishing again. Very similar process for the subscriber. Subscriber opens the bidirectional stream, gets a subscribe handler. The subscribe handler checks the credentials, checks the placement, checks the topics, creates a subscriber ID, saves some information about the subscriber's consumer group, and then it doesn't go to the broker. It goes to a consumer group handler, and then the consumer group handler goes to the broker. So the consumer group handler is what chooses, like, do I need to start reading from disk first, or do I need to start reading from live events first from the broker? And then it'll start sending events back down to the subscriber, and then it's up to the subscriber to ACK or NAC those events back to the server. So that's sort of a little window, but, you know, we'll have to make subscribing, I think, a to-do. In terms of this architecture. We're almost at time, but we already did talk about the broker. And this is sort of the concurrency model of how we totally order events inside. So we have the broker. We also have the consumer group handler, which is not on here. So so, you know, frankly, I don't think I could talk about any of these other topics in 5 minutes. So we might just have to like quit and talk about MSQL and deduplication later and just use this as sort of a good start for sort of understanding how things are being handled in the sort of the Ensign ecosystem. Are there any questions about any of this right now?
Okay, I'm trying to think, does the, is there like a common case where the user would care about the event's ID?
Is there a common case where the user would care about the event's ID?
Yeah, the, yeah, event's ID.
If they want to select a specific event, the easiest way is to do it with the RLID.
Okay.
If, and then, you know, the RLID is also comparable, so they can order things by the RLID. But yeah, generally speaking, they might not care about the event ID. Also, the timestamp is embedded in the event ID. So like time queries, you know, the user might not know about the RLID, but time queries are happening using the RLID. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, I'm just trying to think if we need to like expose that the SDKs.
Oh, yeah, I mean, I think we should. So the Go SDK does, right? So all of this information is in the event wrapper, right? So the Go SDK does expose like methods for you to access the event ID and the offset and the topic from the event wrapper. No. Sorry about that. So yeah, I think we should have like ability to access that.
Okay.
It might not be a common case.
And the other thing I kind of struggle with from the SDK standpoint is like what to name the type field. So right now my best thing I've come up with is that like the type dot name is like called the schema name or something.
Okay.
Because I think type is like very is like almost too generic for it feels weird to use that as like a parameter sometimes.
Sure. So one thing that I've been doing in the Go SDK is like, you know, parsing these strings like name at v1.0.0.1, right? And so sort of letting both, so schema type's fine if you wanna, or schema name or whatever you want, just schema. And then you could like, you know, parse the version out of the schema, or you could have schema and schema version. So,
yeah,
that works.
Yeah, I guess right now I have a schema and then major version, minor version, patch version. That might be too many parameters. I haven't really decided what to go with yet for the Python side.
Yeah, I think in the Go SDK, I just parse the string. Like it's just scheme, it's just name,
yeah.
It's just like, or it's just type and version, and then I parse the version from the string.
Yeah.
Rather than allowing every single component to come in.
Yeah, I think that makes sense.
And I'm pretty sure that version numbers are more compact when serialized because we're using variants. So I'm pretty sure that if it's like version 100, that's less than a byte of data serialized. Whereas if it's the string v1.0.0, that is 5 bytes of data minimum. So I'm sure there is some place where it flips over, right? Like if you have version like 100,360,422. Some big number dot some big number, then yeah, it's probably harder to store. But actually, no, the string version number would also be bigger because you'd have more characters. So never mind. It is smaller to store just the UN64s with variants than it is to store the string. Okay. Any other questions?
Yeah, I have a question. Assuming I'm a data scientist, how does the ETL process happen in Ensign? Like, where does that live? Does that make sense? You extract it, right, from a source, you transform it, and then you load it into a target, right? But you should be able to like do the transformation somewhere. So where does that, like, how does that happen, or where does that happen? I don't even know if I'm asking the right question. I'm just asking from like a data scientist perspective.
Okay.
Or if that's a bigger question, then we can leave it for next time.
Yeah, I mean, it's like a data store question, but it's not an architectural question, but I can show you what happens inside of Ensign. Sorry, I had to close my... So the way that it looks for a user is, let's say that they have some, you know, API where they're fetching the data from, right? So this is the source. So what they'll do is they'll create some process that makes queries. Every 5 min or something, right? And then for row in result, it's going to publish an event. So this is the ingest process to a topic. Right. And then they'll have a transform process that's going to subscribe to this topic. Right. And then for event transform. And then this guy is going to publish a new event. Right, to another topic. And then, you know, up here, you might have the load process, which is going to sub to this topic. Right, and then this will either be, you know, save to DB. Or maybe, you know, train model or whatever. So this is how you would architect an ETL process with Ensign. So when you're asking like, where's Ensign? Ensign's here. Ensign's here. Right. Ensign is managing this data flow that's flowing between these processes. that the user has defined, right? And they're using the SDK here, here, and here.
Cool. That's very helpful. I feel like I understand it better.
Yep.
Thank you.
And then, you know, why is Ensign valuable to this process? Like, you know, you might be like, okay, well, you're just duplicating data, right? Like, so now there's data that's being stored in this topic, and there's transformed data that's being stored in this topic, right? Like, aren't you like storing the data twice? And I mean, it's different data, right? This is the raw data, this is the raw topic. But like, let's say we want a new application, right? And we want a different transformer, right? So now we might have, you know, new app, and this is going to subscribe to this topic, right? And now it can publish somewhere else, right? So without ever interrupting anything that's happening in the old app, right? You can now just quickly attach to this data flow and get access to this API without having to repeat this again. And this is what we mean by rapid prototyping, right? This thing may have been running for a year. It might be a critical process to the organization, and there's no way, whoops. And I just destroyed this critical process to the organization, and all the executives are freaking out. But there is no way in hell that they're letting anyone access this database, right? This is so important that that database can't be touched. And this isn't exactly the data that this team wants anyway, right? They want the data from here. But now, with no interruption to this process, they can fork out that data out of that topic and use it for something new. And, you know, let's say that they create their own database down here. Well, this database is now separate from this incredibly critical database up here, right? And so this is the data flow, right? Now you can see data is flowing, you know, in multiple streams in different directions, and that's what Ensign is doing for our user. That was actually kind of cool. I'm going to just keep doing this for a while and animate this for the video.
That's exactly what I was going to say. That was pretty cool. So I'm assuming like new app can be extended to new machine learning model or something to that effect. Is that right?
Yeah, I mean, new app can do whatever new app wants to do.
Okay, cool.
Right? And heck, you know, we go a little bit longer. Okay, well, now we actually want data from here, right?
Right.
And we want data from here.
Right.
You know? So, you know, just data flows everywhere. Now, Ensign isn't helping with this part right now, right? But we have talked about, this is when we say like compute, when we talk about providing compute for our customers, like this is what we mean. Like, do we want to run these things for our customers, right? And so we could charge them for compute and we could run their publishers and subscribers, and it wouldn't be an Ensign product. It would be something else. Like, we would call it something else, but we could provide a product that allowed our users to pay us to run these things for them. You know,
so what do they do now since we don't offer that?
They have to either run it on their computer or if they have to run it in their own cloud, right? So for example, 202 right now, these things are running.